good morning and welcome to Family Time this week. It's the end of January already, can you believe it? We'll talk about that in a minute. Let's pray as we begin, shall we? Dear God, thank you for bringing us together once more on this beautiful day with beautiful flowers, a reminder of your creation and a reminder of all that you have brought into our lives. And I thank you for the family that we are as we gather this morning and pray you'll bless our time together. Amen. So it's lovely to see you all again. I know we've got Amber and Adele, Alexander Tim's on, Kenya there, Babs. Good morning to everybody. Just quickly checking if I've missed anyone because I'd hate to miss someone. Jackie and Amy and Summer are there. Oh, excellent. Well, I'm getting some guides at the back, but I can't, you know, write them down, Marlene. I can't come. Anyway, end of January, which means we are almost at the end of Christmas. You're thinking, what? But it's Christmas finished ages ago. But on the 2nd of February, it's what's known as Candlemas. It's the presentation of Jesus as a baby in the temple. So we're juggling some of our stories from last week to this week and all that sort of thing. But this week, it's on Tuesday, the 2nd of February, it's Candlemas. And that is officially when all the lights come down, when Christmas and Epiphany formally ends. But I thought we could look briefly at that story of when Jesus was presented in the temple. And we're looking in Luke's Gospel for this particular story. Because I wonder how long you can wait for something. I know Advent is a long time of waiting. I know that you get the excitement of the presents. I know that we've been waiting for this pandemic to finish, haven't we, for a long time now. We're thinking this time last year we were hearing about it, and then of course it all hit and we went into lockdown, and we thought, well, it'll all be finished by September. And here we are still in another lockdown and still in the midst of all the danger that the coronavirus presents itself. And that's been almost a year now. How long can we wait for something to finish? Could you wait over 60 years for something? Because in our story today, we've got a couple of people who waited that long to hear and to see the Lord. There's one of the characters, Anna. She was, doesn't say exactly how long it was when she was first widowed when her husband died, but working it out, she must have been going to the temple almost 60 years, waiting to see the Messiah. And there's another chap, Simeon. Now he was very old, and he had been waiting on the Lord to show him the Messiah. And this amazing thing happens because Jesus is taken into the temple with Mary and Joseph. He's only a baby, and no one else recognizes who this amazing child is. We know, because we've read the story, we know that it's the Messiah, it's Jesus, born to be king. But no one else recognized them. They were just a young couple with a baby coming, and in those days, you had to bring your child to the temple for what was known as purification ritual and all this sort of stuff within a certain time scale. And they'd brought their baby. No one else recognized them, but Simeon and Anna. They saw Jesus and recognized him as the Messiah. And Jesus and Simeon actually says, he says these wonderful words, for my eyes have seen your salvation. You are a light to the Gentiles, a light to the nations of all the world. So they were actually able to see what it was that Jesus, who Jesus was, was and is and continues to be for us. So I'm going to come down now a little bit. Sorry, wait, there we are. And I was wondering, in a way, it's almost like, I don't know if you often hear me say things like, if we have eyes to see or ears to hear God working, we know what God is wanting to do in our lives. In a way, that's what it was for Simeon. He had been waiting for the Messiah to appear. And when he saw Jesus, he recognized him. He recognized all that was happening. And he saw the Messiah in Jesus. So he was celebrating. He was thanking God that he had finally seen. Because God had promised to him, you would not die before you saw the Messiah. And so Simeon got to see the Messiah. So in a way, it's almost like having a set of glasses, a special set of glasses, to see what the Lord is doing. So I thought I could have some fun with all these marker pens and choose some colours. Now, whether I get the colours in the right order or whether they will look good, I'm not sure, but let's see. These are nice. I like these. Now, I don't know how this is going to work. I can see Marlene frowning. Now she's smiling. But whether I get this in a good order or not, I'm going to go over the edges. Oh, it's going to be fun doing this. I've never used highlighters just to colour before. Use them to highlight, obviously. But this is fun just doing this. I'm going to start down here as well. Now this one you might not see so much because it's almost the same yellow as the car behind it. I like that. So can you imagine waiting all that time for something special, and then when you see it, you recognize it? And also because probably Simeon and Anna, all that time, they've been thinking, what will it look like when the Lord comes? I wonder how we'll react. What will everything look like? Because that's the amazing thing, that it all happened. They didn't know exactly what it was they were looking for. I mean, yes, they're looking for a human, but actually, I wonder if they were looking for an adult that was going to come, an adult that would bring this good news, would be the Messiah. I wonder if that's what Simeon was looking for, or whether he thought, he knew, I'll see a baby first, and then it'll become obvious later on. I wonder what it was that he was waiting, how he was waiting, what he was expecting. I don't mind this because I want to write something on this as well, so I want it so you can see what I write when I write it. Oh, I like this. I won't look. How's it looking, Marley? It's okay?
Yeah.
Oh, good. That's quite colourful, actually. I like that. Should I do the arms as well, do you think? Do you think the arms need doing? No, the arms don't need. We don't need to concentrate on the arms. So, we've got our quite nice glasses, very colourful, and I'm just going to write on it what Simeon actually said. He said, "For my eyes have seen your salvation." He's talking to God, he's praying to God. So he says, "For my eyes have seen your salvation." And that's Luke 2, verse 30. Don't know if you can see that okay. How's that looking? Yeah, good. And he says also that he's a light to the world. Now let's quickly finish these off. Let's get these arms on, because then I can actually put these glasses on and see if they work. This is a bit where I suddenly think I'm not sure if that's going to work quite so well. I've done that the wrong way around. I think I should have wrapped it. I think I'm going to wrap something up, because I had too long a piece of sellotape to work out exactly how I was going to do it. That's one side. Got a fold in it, that's good. And let's get the other one on. Oops. Again, I've done a big load of sellotape, probably too much for what I needed, but let's see if I can put that on. Almost there. How's that? I've got a pair of glasses. I've got to try them on, haven't I? How do they look? Now, of course, it doesn't mean that I need to wear special glasses to see what the Lord is saying, or that I can see what the Lord is doing for us. But it's a symbol of making us think we need to pray and to listen to God and to try and find out what it is God is saying to us in our lives, for the nation around us, as we pray for vaccines, as we pray pray for schools, as we pray for our teachers, as we pray for our families, in all that we're going through, that we can hear what God is saying to each one of us at this time. So, it's what we see, it's what we hear. We don't need the special glasses, but we can pray to God that he'll give us the right vision to see what's going on and to hear what's going on around us. So, do they look okay? Should I colour the arms in? That's interesting, actually, looking at itself. Actually, they don't look too bad. I'm quite pleased. They almost go with the flowers to my side, don't they? Anyway, I'm going to take those off for the moment, and then I don't have to squint while I look at you for the end. Because the other day, the other name for what we call this, the presentation of Christ in the temple, is Candlemas. Because, as I said, Simeon said, "For you are a light to the world." And of course, we always talk about Christ being the light. And so, what I think, I shall bring these candles around. Hopefully you'll be able to see them. These are the candles that are normally on the... There we are. Oh, you can see they're burnt down slightly different heights because of the way the wind and the breeze blows through the church. But because it's Candlemas, let me find the candles. And we can have that reminder that Jesus is a light in the world. So let's light our two candles. And shall we pray? Lord, thank you for being with us. Thank you for coming into this world and coming to know us so that we could know you. This week, as we remember all that you have done for us, help us to have eyes to see, ears to hear what it is you are wanting us to be and what you're wanting us to do in our lives, for ourselves, for the world around us, and hearing what you are planning for us. And may we always remember that you are the light in this world. And so we pray for your blessing this week, all that we do. In your name we pray, dear Jesus. Amen. So, let's see who else has joined us as we've been going on. It's been lovely seeing a few names. Oh, Joe, you're on. Hi, good to see you, Joe. Becky, hi. And Mary, very good. Lovely to have you all with us. Vision to see the light in all circumstances. Very well put. And yes, who needs spectators when you've got the Lord's vision? On that note, have a great week. Please stay safe and look out for one another. And God bless, and see you very soon, I hope. Bye for now.